الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، we continue with our شرح of العقيدة الواسطية للشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله. And alhamdulillah, we had been dealing with the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal speaks, and that we Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we ask Allah to make us among them today and die among them and be resurrected with them on the Day of Judgment. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the saved, checked, the people who didn't go left or right when it came to the belief system particularly, we believe that Allah speaks, and we attribute the quality of or the attribute of speech to Allah, kalam in Arabic. And we had been quoting a number of ayat, and we have actually stopped at the seventh ayah. The sixth ayah. The Shaykh rahimahullah says that ayah to sadisa, قوله منهم من كلم الله. Among them are those who Allah spoke to. Okay. Now this is, of course, this is Surah Al-Baqarah verse 253. In the context of those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had inspired unto them revelation. And according to surah, in another surah, the way Allah Azza wa Jal, actually the type of expressions from Allah to His creation or to the prophets in the dunya is of three kinds. This is beside the subject. Either Allah Azza wa Jal will wahyan, inspiration, Allah inspires onto them whatever Allah wants. For example, in the form of a dream, Ibrahim alayhi salatu salam, when he saw in his dream that he is slaughtering his son Ismail, this was actually wahy. Ya Ibrahim, قد صدقت الرؤيا. Allah told him Surah As-Saffat, oh Ibrahim, you have fulfilled the vision, the dream which he had, which is him, you know, being commanded to slaughter Ismail. So that's one form. The dreams of the prophets are a form of revelation. Another one is وراء حجاب, from behind. I'm not used to it. From behind a hijab. What is a hijab? Partition, veil, something along these lines, right? Such as Allah speaking to Musa. Musa, did he see Allah? Did Musa see Allah?
No.
Did he ask to see Allah?
Yes.
Where?
No.
The evidence for that. Does anyone know the evidence?
If I reveal myself, and then he revealed Allah, and then the mountain God.
I believe it's Surah Al-Araf. Surah Al-Araf. قال ربي أرني أنظر إليك. قال لن تراني. He said, my Lord, allow me to look at you. He said, you will not be able to see me. ولكن انظر إلى الجبل. But look at the mountain. If it remains in its place, then you shall see me. Then when Allah revealed some of His majesty to the mountain crushed, and Musa رضي الله عنه وعليه الصلاة والسلام passed out, he fainted. Okay. So in the Quran, Musa asked to see Allah. However, no one can see Allah in the dunya, but can Allah be seen in the hereafter?
Yes.
For sure. This is part of our belief, and we will have plenty of discussions concerning that very subject matter. Then the last kind, then where Allah, the last kind of revelation is through an angel, Jibreel alayhi salatu salam, like the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in many times that Jibreel will come from Allah with information, with verses or otherwise, which he will convey to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. طيب. The second one was وراء حجاب, behind a partition. So either it's an inspiration, a dream, or behind a veil, like with Musa, or through an angel, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. طيب, منهم أي من الرسل. Among them, منهم here is referring to من, of course, is حرف جر, which in English is known as a preposition, and the ha is a pronoun referring to them, right? And the meme is for plurality. So just so you know how technical the Arabic language is, in only minhum you have all these things. You have a pronoun, and you have a plurality through one letter, and you have a preposition. So minhum man kallam Allah, among them that is referring to the messengers are those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to. Al-ismul kareem Allah fa'ilun, aw lafdul jalala fa'ilu kallam. the noble name, the lafdhul jalala, the name of majesty, Allah is the actual doer of the action. He's the one doing the particular action, which is kalam, speaking. So the verb and the doer of the verb, you know, however you would like to, in English it may be considered the subject or something along these lines, sometimes. وَمَفْعُولُهَا مَحْذُوفٌ يَعُودُ عَلَى مَنْ وَتَقْدِيرْ كَلَّمَهُ اللَّهِ. Anyways, grammar, very complicated grammar. Since we're not at that level yet, we will simply يعني disregard this sophistication. الآية السابعة, the seventh ayah, قوله ولما جاء موسى لميقاتنا وكلمه ربه. سورة الأعراف verse 143. And when Musa came out to the time and place appointed by us, and his Lord spoke to him. Okay. So أفادت هذه الآية أن الكلام يتعلق بمشيئته. The important part in this ayah is that the speech of Allah has to do with his will. Allah's speech has to do with his will, because you see that among the Muslims, those who don't believe that. But we Ahl-Sunnah al-Jama'ah believe Allah speaks whenever he wills, however he wills, to whomever he wills, as long as he wills, in whichever manner he wills, it's all up to Allah. So this ayah indicates that, وَذَلِكَ لِأَنَّ الْكَلَامِ صَرَى حِينَ الْمَجِيءِ. Because the speech took place when Musa came. When Musa came to the appointed time and place, Allah spoke to him. So that means that the speech of Allah was conditional to an event. You see what I'm saying? There was a will involved. Because you will find among the Asha'ira and the Mu'tazilites, those who say that if Allah spoke, we cannot say that at a particular time. You know? It's like something just general. But it cannot be involved with, you know, because they think that if you do this, you're making it like the creation. So they deny that Allah spoke. But the ayah says that when Musa came to the appointed time and place, then Allah, then his Lord spoke to him. So, you know, there's this sequence of events here. Jameel. لا سابقا عليه. فدل هذا على أن كلامه يتعلق بمشيئته. This indicates that Allah's speech is relevant to his will. فيبطل به قول من قال إن كلامه هو المعنى القائم بالنفس. So this negates the statement of those who say that Allah's speech is like a meaning that is just out there. It's just like a meaning. It's not really words, it's not really letters, it's not really sound. It's just like a concept. Okay, this is what they claim. It's just a concept. وَأَنَّهُ لَا يَتَعَلَّقْ بِمَشِيئَتِهِ كَمَا تَقُولُ الْأَشَاعِرَ. And that it is not irrelevant, it has nothing to do with Allah's will. And this is how the Asha'irites, or the Ash'arites, I'm sorry, express their views. And the Ash'arites come from following the Ash'ari, which was, I believe it's Abu Musa, no, not Abu Musa, this was the Sahabi. There was one of the Ash'ara who repented before he died. Yani he's the one who began this madhab of negating Allah's names and attributes. Then students became, you know, followers of him. And then his madhab became popular. But he himself authored a book in which he declared his repentance from this wicked, deviant way of understanding the names and attributes of Allah. And he returned to Ahl-Sunnah al-Jama'ah, and he died as from among Ahl-Sunnah al-Jama'ah. But the name remained. The name Ash'arites remained in reference to him, even though he himself did not remain in this fashion until he died. So may Allah have mercy on him and reward him with goodness for returning to the truth. طيب. وفي هذه الآية إبطال من زعم أن موسى فقط هو الذي كلم الله وحرف قوله تعالى وكلم الله موسى تكليما إلى نصب الاسم الكريم لأنه في هذه الآية لا يمكنه زعم ذلك ولا تحريفها. This is important because we dealt with in the previous session, if you were not here, that in this ayah there's a negation against those, or there's a refutation against those who say that it is only Musa who spoke to Allah. And they use the ayah وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Remember I told you, if we were to change وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا to وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهَ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا, we will turn the object to the subject and the subject to the object, meaning it becomes Musa the speaker and Allah the one who is receiving the speech, because we made اللَّهَ with a fatha مَفْعُول بِهِ in the grammar. However, so they twisted that. They said, okay, you know, the ayah doesn't say وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ, Allah is the one who spoke to Musa. They said the ayah is وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهَ, Musa is the doer of the action. But so this is their claim. However, with this ayah we just quoted, you can't do that. because it says وكلمه ربه and his Lord spoke unto him, and you cannot change that. You cannot say وكلمه ربه. Now grammatically they are shackled. They can't try to twist the deen or twist the Quran around, and the many other ayat also. So alhamdulillah, you know, in the Quran there is a reputation against those who try to twist the meaning of the Quran. The eighth ayah, الآية الثامنة, قوله وناديناه من جانب الطور الأيمن وقربناه نجيا. سورة مريم verse 52, and we called him from the right side of the mount and made him draw near to us for a talk with موسى عليه الصلاة والسلام. Look how interesting this ayah is. وناديناه, ضمير الفاعل يعود إلى الله. The pronoun of the subject is referring to Allah. وناديناه, meaning the one who called, is Allah. وضمير المفعول يعود إلى موسى, and the pronoun of the object of the sentence is in reference to موسى. أي نادى الله موسى, meaning Allah called on to موسى. Now this is very important. Why is this important? وناديناه, أي نعم, ونجية حال وهو فعيل بمعنى مفعول أي مناجاة. Okay, this is grammar. Now here it says نادى. Who knows what that means? Calling. In exactly how though?
He called.
طيب, but calling in what? In what manner? Because the nida in the language, nida has a particular meaning, a particular way of calling.
It's hard to swift calling. It's a little bit
exactly. Loud. It's actually loud. It's as you're reaching out to someone who is far. So this is nida, right? So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he spoke of the adhan, he said in the hadith, لو أن الناس يعلمون ما في النداء والصف الأول ثم لم يجدوا إلا يستهموا عليه لاستهموا عليه. If the people knew what kind of reward was awaiting them in calling the adhan, nida, calling the adhan, because are you calling people next to you in the masjid? No, you're calling the people in their homes all over the place. And the first row, and they had no option but to draw lots, then they would have drawn lots in order to get that virtue, right? So he called it what? Nida. So nida, it requires raising the voice and calling someone who is far. Very important. طيب. والفرق بين المنادات والمناجات أن المنادات تكون البعيد. So منادات is for the one who is far. مناجات, do you remember this word? We dealt with it earlier. نجية or يناجي. لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا من أمر بصدقة أو معروف أو صلح بين الناس. There is no, what do we call it? Private
whispering.
A private consultation. Private, you know, whispering, talking to each other in a privacy. Remember, we dealt with it in a number of times. We said najwa. Allah mentioned the ayah before in the ma'iyah that they aren't two who have in a private conversation except that Allah Azza wa Jalla is their third, and the end of the ayat. فجميل. إذا أن والمناجاة تكون للقريب وكلاهما كلام. So then munajat is for the far, munajat is for the near, and both of them are a form of speech. So in one ayah Allah says وناديناه من جانب الطور, and we called onto him from the right side of the mountain. وقربناه نجيا, and then we brought him near for a private talk. So it was calling out first, and then يعني two kinds of speech were affirmed in one ayah, and these people still don't believe. لا إله إلا الله. وكون الله عز وجل يتكلم مناداته ومناجات داخل في قول السلف كيف شاء. The fact that Allah speaks in both ways, in both manners, by calling out to the far or the one who is near, is a confirmation of the aqidah of the salaf, which is the fact that Allah speaks as He wills. He speaks in a manner which is pleasing to Him. If He wants to call out, He does, and if He wants to bring someone near, He does. So it's according to Allah. And so this is what we believe as well. Alhamdulillah. طيب. فهذه الآية مما يدل على أن الله يتكلم كيف شاء منادات كان الكلام أو مناجات. So the ayah indicates that Allah speaks however He wills, be it calling out to the far or a private conversation with one who is near. الآية التاسعة, the ninth verse. قوله وإذ نادى ربك موسى أن ائت القوم الظالمين. Again, you find that most of the ayat dealing with the speech have to do with Musa. Consequently, he is called كليم الله. It should be كليمه. Unless it came in a sentence where it was مفعول به or منصوب, then it becomes كليم الله, or it could be كليم الله. But the أصل is كليم الله. It's كليم الله. إبراهيم
كليم
الله. Good. عيسى روح الله وكلمته. Right? A spirit by Allah. Of course, not as many people like will understand that he is Allah's spirit. A'udhu billah. He's a spirit, he created by the command of Allah in a special manner. He was born without a father. This was so it is referred to Allah as means of what? Honoring. The same way you say, Baytullah is the Kaaba, the house of Allah, as in the house of Allah. A'udhu billah. Naqatullah, does Allah, the camel of Allah. What does it mean? In me honoring it. So we use this kind of mudaf idafa, this possessive form, in order to raise the status of that which is being mentioned. So it's something that is not it's something that is unique, not normal. So Isa is called Ruhullah, as in he's a special soul created by Allah. The same way we say Baytullah, Naqatullah. Be careful, because you might get some Christians who read some of the Islamic material and they say, hey, what do you mean he's Allah's spirit? What do you mean he's Allah's soul, right? So you have to know what's going on here so you will not fall into the trap. They say, okay, this is exactly what we believe, that Jesus is God. And the Quran confirms it, right? But usually most Christians are as ignorant as they can be, so they don't know what's going on. Alhamdulillah, so we get by many times. Otherwise we'll be in trouble sometimes. Okay, if we don't know, but we're not in trouble because, you know, we have everything. We have an answer for every nonsense they bring about. Now. And when your Lord called Musa, go to the people who are zalimun. What is zalimun?
Deviant.
Dalun is deviant.
Oppressive.
Right? Zulm can be mushrikun. Right? I mean, it depending on the context. A Muslim committing zulm is oppression. A kafir committing zulm, it could be that he's committing shirk, because Luqman said to his son, "Inna shirka la zulmun azim." Verily, shirk is great oppression. So shirk here was called zulm, and many other ayat indicate that the mushrikeen are the zalimun. Ala kulli hal. This was Surah Al-Shu'ara, the poets, verse 10. وَإِذْ نَادَى يعني وَاذْكُرْ إِذْ نَادَى وَإِذْ نَادَى meaning mention, remember when your Lord called. وَشَاهَدْ قَوْلُهُ رَبُّكَ مُوسَى Your Lord called on to Musa. فَسَّرَ النِّدَى بِقَوْلِ أَنْ اِئْتِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ He explained what calling, what was the calling? What did Allah call with? That go to the people who are ظالمون. This was the manifestation of the call. Allah called them with what command? That go to the people who are ظالمون. Who are those? Fir'aun. And what is the name of his minister? Harun? Hoi! Karun, okay, now that's not his minister. Haman. Hey, I was thought you said Harun, brother, so he got it backwards. Harun and Musa are the prophets of Allah. Haman is the minister. And Karun is this very, you know, rich man who thought he was very special until Allah caused the earth to swallow him. It's in the Quran. Right? It's in the Quran. He was so rich that his keys, the keys of his treasures, required the strongest of men to carry the keys. And some of the Mufassirin say the keys were made of leather. It wasn't like gold, leather. His keys required the strongest of men. They had a hard time carrying his keys. Don't ask about his treasures. He came out, you know, looking all nice and fancy, and that was the end of it. Right? Because they advised him, they said, لا تفرح. Don't be happy. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَرِحِينَ Allah does not love those who are extra contented. Meaning they're happy not because of Iman or because of some good deeds they perform. No, no, no. They're happy, you know, this kind of arrogant happiness, a prideful happiness. He said, I brought this, you know, with my own knowledge. I'm a businessman. I know what I'm doing and so on and so forth. So they advised him. He listened not. And Allah Azza wa Jal gave him his punishment in the dunya. And what is waiting for him in the hereafter is much more. طيب. فالنداء يدل على أنه بصوت. The fact that the نداء is an indication that there's a voice involved, because Allah told him أن ائتي القوم الظالمين, يدل على أنه بحرف. And the fact that Allah says أن ائتي القوم الظالمين means they are letters, because Allah told him that أن ائتي القوم الظالمين. سبحان الله. طيب, the 10th verse, سورة الأعراف, verse 22, قوله وناداهما ربهما ألم أنهكما عن تلكما الشجرة. Who are we speaking about here? You should know by the context.
Adam
and Eve. Was it an apple tree? Was it an apple tree?
No mention.
No mention in the Quran and the Sunnah actually what kind of tree it is. According to the Christians, it's an apple tree, but we don't make that claim. Because this, first of all, the ulama say this is from the knowledge which is unimportant. What does it matter what kind of tree it is? The wisdom is behind the event and what happened. And we don't have anything confirming it's an apple tree, so we leave it alone. It's a tree. They were prohibited from consuming a tree or the fruits of a tree, and khalas, that's what it is. Right. Their Lord called on to them, did I not prevent you or prohibit you from that particular tree, from consuming the fruits of that tree? وناداهما ضمير مفعول به يعود على آدم وحواء. Again, the pronoun here, هما, refers to both Adam and Eve, or Adam وحواء. ألم أنهكما عن تلكما الشجرة, يقرر أنه نهاهما عن تلكما الشجرة. It confirms that Allah speaks when He wants to speak. وهذا يدل على أن الله كلمهما من قبل. It's an indication that Allah had spoken to them beforehand. يعني I had already told you don't consume this tree. First Allah called on to them after they ate from the tree. Did I not tell you before that you shouldn't eat from this tree? Subhanallah. So this is all further confirmation. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله. وأن كلام الله بصوت وحرف. And that Allah's speech has a voice, has a sound. Let's say a sound and a letter. Right? Letters, words. They can letters which consist words and words consist sentences and خلاص. That's what it is. Regular speech. ويدل على أنه يتعلق بمشيئتي. Furthermore, it indicates that it has to do with Allah's will. That Allah will to speak to them after they consume the fruit of that particular tree. لقوله ألم أنهكما, because Allah said, did I not prevent you? فإن هذا القول بعد النهي. فيكون متعلقا بالمشيئة. So this expression came after the prohibition, which is an indication that it is relevant to Allah's will. It has to do with Allah's will. Meaning, like we said, أخي, the Ash'ari said that Allah, you cannot say that Allah speaks when He wills. They said speech is like, it's just a concept which we have, but it has nothing to do with the occurrence of events. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we say no, Allah speaks whenever He wants, according to His will. He will to speak because of this event, so He did. Because they make the speech a broad concept, whereas we believe in it in this very particular fashion. Allah calls on people, Allah speaks when events happen, Allah prohibits, commands, and it's a regular speech. So, and it's relevant to His will. Meaning when Allah willed, He spoke. You see what I'm saying? Clear?
So because of an event, as a consequence of an event, Allah spoke, I mean, is it linked?
I mean, this is, yes, this is what we understand, that it is relevant to the event taking place. And that means that Allah's will is there. Because Allah willed that this event will take place for Him to speak. Because everything is under Allah's will. So it's not something that is, ambiguous as they try to claim. لا بأس, inshallah. جميل. الآية الحادية عشر, and this is the last one, the 11th آية, قوله ويوم يناديهم فيقول ماذا أجبتم المرسلين. الله أكبر. And the day Allah will call unto them and will say, what answer gave you to the messengers? Or in other words, in a more less eloquent way, what answer did you give the messengers? What did you answer the messengers who had called you to the worship of Allah alone and believing in His messengers? This is Surah Al-Qasas, verse 65. يعني واذكر يوم يناديهم وذلك يوم القيامة والمنادي هو الله عز وجل فيقول. So and remember when Allah will call unto them, and that is on the day of judgment, and the one who will call is Allah Azza wa Jal. And this basically affirms that Allah's speech in two ways. Raising of voice, speech occurs in sounds, letters, and sentences. وفي هذه الآية إثبات الكلام من وجهين النداء والقول. And in this ayah we affirm Allah's speech from two different angles, calling and speaking. He will call unto them. وَيَوْمَ يُنَادِيهِمْ مَاذَا أَجَبْتُمُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. On the day he will call them, what did you answer the messengers? So first he called unto them, then he spoke to them. You see the point here. وَهَذِهِ الْآيَاتُ تَدُلُّ بِمَجْمُوعِهَا عَلَى أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَتَكَلَّمْ بِكَلَامٍ حَقِيقِيٍ. These ayat collectively confirm and affirm that Allah Azza wa Jal speaks in a true manner. Truly speaks. He really speaks. Real speech. مَتَ شَاء. Whenever he wills. بِمَ شَاء. With whatever he wills. يعني he says whatever he wills. كَيْفَ شَاء. However he wills. بِحَرْفٍ وَصَوْتٍ مَسْمُوعٍ. With a letter and a sound that is audible, that you can hear. لَا يُمَاثِلْ أَصْوَاتُ الْمَخْلُوقِينَ. And the most important element here, it is unlike the sounds of the creation. It is unlike the voices of the creation. That's for sure. So we don't imagine a particular voice that is like a thick voice or something along these lines. We don't have any of that stuff, right? How? Allahu A'lam. But Allah speaks. That's what we believe. وَهَذِهِ هِيَ الْعَقِيدَةُ السَّلَفِيَّةِ عَقِيدَةُ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ. And this is the Salafi عَقِيدَة. The Aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah Jama'ah. Sure enough, the Shaykh is not speaking about the sect of the Salaf, because we have a sect today called Salafis. Sometimes they express themselves in different countries with other names. I'm not going to mention any names to keep the conversation or the discussion closed. But the bottom line is, when we speak of Salafiyya and Salafi and so on and so forth, we are speaking of the adjective and not the proper noun. Because you can have a proper noun. You could be a doctor as an adjective, meaning you're so a professor. If you go to look up the word professor in the dictionary, a professor is someone who is well versed in something. I mean, you know everything about this. So like you're a professor in cell phones. That's an adjective. Even though you may not be a professor as in the highest rank in a university. Right? So a proper noun, Professor Ahmed, is because he has a title professor. He graduated as a professor and he is teaching at the university as a professor. That's a proper noun. An adjective is simply having this quality, however not being carrying the noun. Did I lose you somewhere along the lines? According to your facial expressions, I have. Again, the adjective which we hold is Salafiyya. You must be a Salafi, you have no choice anyways. You have to be living Islam according to the understanding of the righteous predecessors. Case closed. But do you carry a banner? Do you have a membership card belonging to a group called Salafis or Ahli Hadith or blah blah? Now we can enumerate the number of how they spread out in different ways and different forms. Do you have to be a membership card holder? Can you only speak in the name of the club? Otherwise, you're deviant. This is what has happened. People wanted goodness and the shaitan tricked them into extremism and they fell into the very thing that we have been trying to avoid all the time, dividing the ummah. So now in the name of the sunnah and loving the sunnah, we divide the ummah. And this is not the way of the salaf. In the name of the sunnah, we unite the ummah. So that means you have to interact with the others, you have to bring them to the truth. Back then everybody was upon the sunnah, few innovators. Today, almost everyone is an innovator and there are too few people following the sunnah. How many people in the Muslim world do not practice al-Mawlid al-Nabawi? How many? A small percentage. We may even constitute maybe 5-10%. Everywhere else in the world, it's like the norm is to celebrate the Mawlid al-Nabawi. You'll be considered abnormal if you didn't. But if we boycott all these people, okay, these are all ta'ban. They're not Ahli Hadith, they're not Salafis. Who's going to lead them? Who's going to guide them to abandoning the Mawlid al-Nabawi? Who? their shuyukh? No. It's our obligation to convey to them the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I mean, you know, we have to be very technical here. You know, yes, these groups are the ones who are carrying the sunnah, conveying the sunnah, propagating the sunnah. May Allah reward them with goodness. But as Shaykh bin Uthameen himself had mentioned in the Sharh al-Arba'in Nawawiyyah, we don't belong to any group. Don't become a member of any group on the scene today, before or after, because this is not safe. What you belong to is the understanding of the Salaf. So you are a Salafi in Aqeedah, Salafi in Manhaj, Salafi in your way of life, but you don't have to be called a Salafi on your last name or Al-Athari or whatever other words, even though you yourself are not living like the Salaf. Most of these Salafis don't even know the Fatiha. They don't know the Fatiha. Can you meet a Salafi, one of the Salaf who doesn't know the Fatiha? They were ulama, ya Shaykh. They were people of knowledge, practicing the knowledge. Today we just get titles, you know, big Shaykh, big whatever, because he's refuting everybody on the scene. But you know, it doesn't work this way. So this is what I'm upon. Hayakumullah, if you agree with me. And if you don't, hayakumullah anyways. I hope you agree with me at some point. This what I'm upon is the way of the ulama, the major ulama, not the smaller ones who come up with different things every other day. Shaykh bin Baz, Shaykh bin Uthaymeen, even Shaykh Albani rahimahullah, he was not of this kind of extremism that the people misunderstood from him when he dealt with the word Salafiyya, and other of among the ulama, right? And there are others who say you have to be a Salafi, you have to call yourself a Salafi, you must be Ahli Hadith, and you must call yourself Ahli Hadith, and if you don't, you are blah blah blah. That's a whole other discussion. I don't agree with them, and I wish never to agree with them, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallah feekum. Nah. So anyways, this is what we believe. Al-Aqeedah Salafiyya, the Salafi Aqeedah of Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So now we're moving on to a very important subject matter. إثبات أن القرآن كلام الله. Translate.
The proof that Quran is the speech.
ما شاء الله. Are you a qualified translator? If I give you documents later on, maybe you can do the work for me, inshallah. Proving that the Quran is the speech of Allah, right? Is it? Let's have a quick pop quiz here, since I'm in the school business. Brother, is the Quran the speech of Allah?
Yes.
Can you give us like a small definition? Like when we speak of the Quran, like what is it?
What is commandment and his prohibition and commands
only commands and prohibitions?
The way of life.
Are there narratives in the Quran?
Yeah.
Narratives, yeah. Many stories. Yusuf and hey, and you know the stories of Sulaiman and Dawood and others. Okay. How about any? Are there any prophecies in the Quran?
Yeah.
Prophecies of future events?
Yes.
Of course.
Qiyamah.
Yeah. The Qiyamah, the whole thing is a prophecy. No, even otherwise, even like Ghulibat al-Rum. About the Romans and the defeats of the Romans, and that in a few years that they were, you know, the whole thing in the beginning of Surah Ar-Rum, this was a manifest, the prophecy of that Abu Lahab will die a kafir. Tabbat yada Abi Lahab, and what was revealed early on. And all the man had to do was pretend to be a Muslim, even as a hypocrite, to negate the Quran. He could have come and said, okay, I'm a Muslim now, and now what are we going to do with Tabbat yada Abi Lahab, and what Allah declared that he's going to Jahannam. This would have been a disaster, right? But Allah prophesied way early on that this man will never become a Muslim, not even as a hypocrite. And he died as a lousy kafir. So tabbat yada Abi Lahab wa tab will remain ever effective. This is ajeeb. Because he could have played a game. Said, okay, this surah is on me. Okay, I'm a Muslim now. Now what? Subhanallah, he wasn't even guided to pretend to be a Muslim. So actually we will see what the ulama give us a very beautiful definition of the Quran being the speech of Allah. That it came from Allah, it was, you know, minhu bada wa ilayhi ya'ud, munazzal ghayru makhluq, it is sent down, it is uncreated, it's from Allah, to him it will return. And you will see inshallah the definition of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. ثم ذكر المؤلف رحمه الله الآيات الدالة على أن القرآن كلام الله. The author, may Allah have mercy on him, went on to quote or cite the verses or the evidences which prove that the Quran is the speech of Allah. وهذه المسألة وقع فيها النزاع الكثير بين المعتزلة وأهل السنة وأهل السنة عفوا. This matter has caused a lot of issues between the Mu'tazilites and Ahl Sunnah, right? We don't agree with them as usual. وحصل بها شر كثير, and a lot of evil occurred due to that. على أهل السنة, upon أهل السنة, we suffered because of this concept. وممن أوذي في الله في ذلك الإمام أحمد ابن حنبل, right? أحمد بن حنبل or not? No? Huh? No? You're not sure? Okay, good. I like that answer. بارك الله فيك. رحمه الله إمام أهل السنة. This is why it's called إمام أهل السنة. Not that إمام أبو حنيفة is not, and إمام شافعي and إمام مالك. All of them the إمام of the سنة. But إمام أحمد, he was a little extra keen on the سنة. And here he Allah يعني used him as means to preserve the عقيدة. You will see. Amazing what happened to him. الذي قال فيه بعض العلماء إن الله سبحانه وتعالى حفظ الإسلام أو قال نصره بأبي بكر يوم الردة وبالإمام أحمد يوم المحنة. This is why the ulama say that Allah سبحانه وتعالى has preserved or protected Islam or had aided Islam on the with Abu Bakr on the day the people apostated. You know what happened. After Prophet ﷺ died, the Arabs started leaving Islam. Some of them said, we're not going to pay zakah anymore. And others just started to fall out. And Musaylam al-Kadhab was in the picture. And a whole number of things were going on. And people were apostating from the religion of Islam. People were leaving Islam. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Allah gave him this inspiration, this understanding to go for this fight and to bring the people back. Alhamdulillah, success was brought. So Allah protected Islam and the people on the day of Ridda through Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and on Yawm al-Mihna, the day of the test, through Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. We will see what happened. وَالْمِحْنَا أَنَّ الْمَأْمُونَ عَفَى اللَّهُ عَنَّا وَعَنْهُ أَجْبَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَقُولُوا بِخَلْقِ الْقُرْآنِ حَتَّى إِنَّهُ صَارَ يَمْتَحِنِ الْعُلَمَاءَ وَيُقَتِّلَهُمْ إِذَا لَمْ يُجِيبُوا. وأكثر العلماء رأوا أنهم في فسحة من الأمر وصاروا يتأولون. The mihna, the test, was actually that the ma'mun, this is the person, the leader at the time, right? May Allah pardon us and pardon him. He forced the people to say that the Quran is created. The Quran is created. مخلوق. Okay? And so much so that he started testing these scholars. If they did not say that the Quran was created, he was killing them. He would kill them. He would force them to say the Quran is created. If they didn't say the Quran was created, he will get them killed. And many of the ulama during that time found it suitable, or they found that there was some room in this issue because of ta'wil. Ta'wil meaning يعني they try to say something with another intent. Say something with another intent. We will see. إما بأن الحال حال إكراه. First they said, أخي, we're being forced. Right? And we know from the Sunnah that Al Yasir, when Yasir was forced by the Kuffar to disbelieve, to curse the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did. When he came to the Messenger of Allah and he told him, what did the Messenger of Allah tell him? He said, if they do this to you again, then curse again. No problem. Because Allah told us in the Quran, except the one, except إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهُ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ. Except the one who has been forced to lie, to disbelieve, but his heart is secure with faith. So if someone imposes on you something forcefully, which you do not want to do, Islam does not hold you accountable. Okay? You see what I'm saying? So the ulama said, okay, listen man, this guy is going to kill me. So here, just like Yasir, I have an outlet. I can say whatever makes him happy. Okay, the Quran is created, just leave me alone in order to protect my life. And this is one ta'wil that they had. والمكره إذا قال الكفر وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان فإنه معفون عنه. According to the Islamic teachings, if the one who's being forced to say something, he makes an expression of kufr, but his heart is sound and secure with iman, he is pardoned. Okay, but what is the condition? That you are being forced, not that you know just playing around. Because if you playing around and say the statement of kufr, then you have gone outside of Islam, right? على كل حال. وإما بتنزيل اللفظ على غير ظاهره. Or they will use expressions besides the apparent meaning. For example, يتأولون فيقولون مثلا القرآن. Look what they would do. Okay, look what they would do. القرآن والإنجيل والزبور وعفوا القرآن والتوراة والإنجيل والزبور هذه مخلوقة. The Quran, the Torah, the Gospel and the Psalms, these are created. And what they mean is these things are created. Okay? Are you with me? وهذا يتأول بأصابعه. Now you know, Islamically, in some situations you may do that. Okay? You don't become a compulsive liar and you turn this into a habit. However, you may do so at times in order to avoid a greater harm as long as you're not lying. As long as you're not lying, and there's a benefit, there's an Islamic benefit that you want to attain, not playing around. So they said the Quran, the Torah, and then they mean now, the Niyyah now, here's a separate sentence. These are created, brother. And so the man says, okay, they believe that they're created, and they're like, our fingers are created. But we don't believe that. You see what I'm saying? So that's what they did. وَأَمَّا الْإِمَامُ أَحْمَدْ وَمُحَمَّدْ بِن نُوح رَحِمَهُمُ اللَّهِ فأبيا ذلك. As for Imam Ahmad and another Imam named Muhammad bin Nuh, they refused to do that. They refused to do that. وقال القرآن كلام الله منزل غير مخلوق. They said the Quran is the speech of Allah. It is sent down. It is not created. They kept their grounds. They held their grounds. They were tough men. ورأيا أن الإكراه في هذا المقام لا يسوغ لهما أن يقولا خلاف الحق. And they were of the position that this situation does not accommodate the concept of being forced. That there's no room for them claiming that they are being forced and to say something which negates the truth. لأن المقام مقام جهاد. Because here, now this is jihad. Struggling for the sake of Allah with your pen, with your tongue, and not with weaponry, right? والإكراه يقتضي العفو إذا كانت المسألة شخصية. إكراه, being forced, requires of you, to, you know, that you're pardoned if it is personal, if it's a personal matter to you. بمعنى أن تكون على شخص نفسه, meaning that will afflict the person himself. The pain will afflict you personally. وأما إذا كانت المسألة لحفظ شريعة الله, but if the matter requires or deals with preserving the legislation, the divine law of Allah, فالواجب أن يتبرع الإنسان برقبته لحفظ شريعة الله عز وجل. It is expected of the man to donate his own neck in order for the teachings of Islam to be preserved. See the difference? They were looking at it like, look man, this is not about me. This is about me saying something that will become popular among the people. The deen of Allah will be distorted. Forget about me doing ta'wil or being forced. I have to say the truth because this is jihad. And they were, you know, they knew that they would get killed. Other scholars had gotten killed. Meaning the imam was ready to be killed in order to keep his word about what he believes. And look at us today. A bunch of funny people today as Muslims. I'm not speaking about anyone here. We don't even have to be anywhere near this, and we are willing to give it up على طول. يا الله, as long as I am good and secure. This is a man who knew that they will slit his throat. They will kill him if he was to say that the Quran is not created, but he is willing to die for the deen of Allah. And we cannot even, you know, attend the lecture on time sometimes. Allah المستعان. على كل حال, ouch. I have to, you know, kind of pinch you from the side every now and then, because you know when you come late to the lecture, it kind of makes a big mess for me. If they start bringing the chairs, and I just lose my concentration, and everything falls on my head. So hopefully everybody will show up at the lecture, inshallah, right on time, pray in a nearby masjid, and everything will be fine. على كل حال. لو قال الإمام أحمد في ذلك الوقت القرآن مخلوق ولو بتأويل أو لدفع الإكراه لقال الناس كلهم القرآن مخلوق. Had Imam Ahmad رحمه الله said during that time the Quran is created, even if it's ta'wil as the other men, the other scholars did, or because he's being forced in order just to save himself, the whole people would have said, okay, the Quran is created. Imam Ahmad said the Quran is created. He was the Imam of his time without any doubt. You know, he was among the biggest ulama. He was a muhaddith and a alim, faqih. In his Musnad, Imam Ahmad, and they say Imam Ahmad had memorized a million hadith with the sanad, with the chain of narrators. And you cannot even imagine. And he would make no confusion between them. From this man, the names you don't even, you know, memorize. عن أحمد بن عبد الرحمن الأثم, I don't know what, from that قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم such and such and such. A million hadith in his brain. No 20 gigabyte internal memory, no external memory card, no nothing. Just by Allah's will. Do you know? These were the ulama of the ummah, man. You can't find anyone in the world like this. In no religion was anyone of this caliber. This is specific to the ummah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So anyways, everybody would have said the Quran makhluk, because Imam Ahmad said the Quran is makhluk. وَحِنَئِذٍ يَتَغَيَّرُ مُسْتَعْمَى الْإِسْلَامِ مِنْ أَجْلِ دَفْعِ الْإِكْرَاهِ لَكِنَّهُ صَمَّمْ فَصَارَتُ الْعَاقِبَةُ لَهُ وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدِ. So then the whole Islamic community will be changed because of them trying to avoid the harm. However, he was consistent on his statement, and so the good end became his, and all praise is due to Allah. And until now, we, you know, you have to love him in your heart. You've never seen him, you don't know what he looks like, he's not related to you. Maybe you're related to him, you never know. But as far as you know, you're not related to him. But in your heart, there must be some love for Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. Because you feel like, alhamdulillah, that he was persevere at the time where, you know, the deen of Allah needed some protection. So, you know, this was the good end for Imam Ahmad, that we love him for the sake of Allah up until today. And this is sufficient as a good end for someone. Ibrahim had actually asked that, وَجْعَلْ لِي لِسَانَ صِدْقٍ فِي الْآخِرِينَ, and give me a good reputation among the later generations. So Ibrahim had asked that, you know, he wanted Allah to give him a good reputation among the generations that will follow, and indeed Allah answered his supplication. We are speaking of Ibrahim, and we love him as well, alayhi salatu wasalam. Then, نعم. المهم أن القول في القرآن جزء من القول في كلام الله على العموم. The important thing is that the statement that the Quran لحظة أن القول في القرآن جزء من القول في كلام الله على العموم. Okay. The statement that the ruling on the Quran is part of the ruling about Allah's speech anyways, because we believe in Allah's speech and the Quran is the speech of Allah. So, لكن لما وقعت فيه المحنة وصار محل التنازع بين المعتزلة وأهل السنة صار الناس يفردون القول في القرآن بكلام خاص. But when the test took place and there was a huge issues and problems between the معتزلة and أهل السنة, the people started to have a personal opinion about the Quran, that the Quran is not the speech of Allah, that it is created. والمؤلف رحمه الله من الآن ساق الآيات الدالة على أن القرآن كلام الله في آيات متعددة. And the مؤلف, the author, may Allah mercy on him, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, another one of the ulama of Ahl al-Sunnah, he quoted or cited all the آيات which prove that the Quran is the speech of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. So I believe it would be suitable that we leave that portion of beginning the quotation of the ayat until next time, inshallah ta'ala. And I do hope that you show up again, because it's going to get very interesting, right? We're going to deal with, you know, what verses do we use to prove that Allah, the Quran, is the speech of Allah, and how we know this will benefit us in our life and in our life to come. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.